In January, Wang Xiaolong arrived in New Zealand and took over as China's new ambassador, stepping into the role at a time when China's place in the world and China's place in the Pacific is the subject of intense debate. For days, the Chinese military conducted aggressive exercises in the Taiwan Strait, firing missiles into the nearby waters and simulating an attack on the disputed island. A response to a decision by US House Leader Nancy Pelosi, who at the start of this month became the most senior American political figure to visit Taiwan in the last 25 years.
In my opinion, it was reckless, if you want to be kind. It was provocative, and it was actually dangerous.
But the relationship between the superpowers has arguably been deteriorating for some time. Former US President Donald Trump launched a trade war with President Xi Jinping. Then last year, America signed a deal that will eventually give Australia nuclear submarines, a move that China interpreted as a major provocation. In February, China signed a no-limits partnership with Russia, shortly before Vladimir Putin invaded Ukraine. Add to that the debate over China's crackdown on Hong Kong and the impact of the global pandemic. This is an especially tumultuous period for the world order, as two superpowers jockey for position. And in the middle, well, that's us. New Zealand, which culturally and politically identifies more with the liberal democracies of our traditional allies, but whose biggest trading partner is China. Over the last few years on Q&A, we have requested interviews with China's ambassador on many occasions, and every time we've been turned down. Until now. This is the first time Ambassador Wang Xiaolong has been interviewed for TV since he arrived in New Zealand in January. The ambassador studied at the University of Kent, has a PhD in economics, and was previously China's ambassador to Mongolia, as well as holding several other diplomatic positions. The Chinese embassy did not ask for any topics to be off limits. But just so you know, Q&A agreed not to edit anything out of the interview. We hope you too see the value in an extended conversation with China's top representative in Aotearoa. So I sat down at Wellington Museum with Ambassador Wang Xiaolong. Why do you feel it's important to do this interview?
Well, I think in terms of the relationship, the bilateral relationship between New Zealand and China, it is standing at an important juncture because we're faced with a complex and rapidly changing world. Some very complex challenges face both of us. And as for the relationship itself, it keeps evolving in response to some of the changes that are taking place in both countries and around us in the world. So I think it is a good moment to reflect on the relationship and share some of my views and observations with the audience. So thank you for the opportunity.
It's a great pleasure to be speaking with you. Wow. And I think reflections are a really good place to start. Mm. I was interested to note that since 2019, data from Asia New Zealand shows the number of New Zealanders who perceive China as being friendly has dropped to below 30%, and the number of New Zealanders who perceive China as being threatening has almost doubled in that time. And I wondered, why do you think that is?
Well, I've been talking with some of the colleagues in the foundation as well as friends from other circles here in New Zealand and why that is the case. I think part of the reason is the COVID, the impact, the lack of face-to-face exchanges, the visits. So in a way that has contributed to the increasing lack of understanding and the ability to see things as they are. And as honestly speaking, people also tell me that probably the role being played by some of the media here in New Zealand is not being very helpful. Because of COVID, the media is the main channel through which people will access information. For example, for people here in New Zealand about China. So in that way, the media is playing an outsized role. But because of what has happened, there's a lot of misinformation or even disinformation going around about China. That has contributed to, I think, the lack of the accurate understanding of how things are in China. So probably that explains it.
Mm. Mm. Talk to me a little bit more about the media aspect and the media's role in this. Are there specific examples you can think of where you think China has been misrepresented or poorly represented?
Well, you see, the because you when you look at the reports on China carried in on some of the platforms, very often these reports or coverage is sourced somewhere else. Because they're very often syndicated reports originating in some of the foreign media, and a lot of these media, when they cover what is going on in China, making comments, they don't necessarily reflect the real public opinion of New Zealand, and they may not have the best interest of New Zealand at heart.
You said it has contributed to misunderstandings. So what are those misunderstandings?
Well, for example, about what is going on with the COVID, the policies, the approach, the state of the economy, and for example, how some of the foreign policy issues are being approached by China, the impact on the region and the wider world, and how it relates to New Zealand.
Let's focus a little bit on some of those geopolitical issues. Mm. What responsibility does China take for the increased tensions within the Pacific region?
Well, if you mean it's what is going on, for example, across the Taiwan Strait, I think the crux of what is going on, what relates to Taiwan, is the sovereignty and territorial integrity of China and the One China principle associated with it. At the very heart of that principle is the recognition that there is only one China, Taiwan is part of China, and the government of the People's Republic of China is the sole legal representative of China. So that is a widely recognized and supported international consensus, as affirmed, for example, in the UN General Assembly Resolution 2758. It is also the political foundation of the diplomatic relationships we have established with over 180 countries in this world, including New Zealand, including the United States. But what has happened with the latest visit by Speaker Pelosi to Taiwan is an affront to the sovereignty and territorial integrity of China. It is a violation of the commitment made by the United States itself on One China. And it's also a serious threat to peace in the Taiwan Strait and stability in the wider Asia-Pacific region.
As a response to that visit, China held military exercises in the Taiwan Strait for several days. I note that those exercises disrupted shipping, including New Zealand shipping. Is it fair that China's military exercises should impinge New Zealand exporters and their commercial interests in the region?
Well, because of the serious nature of the visit, the impact on China's sovereignty and territorial integrity as a country, we have no choice but to respond. And our response has been legitimate, appropriate, but at the same time measured and proportionate. But first and foremost, it's the countermeasures we have taken are meant to be defensive. to safeguard our sovereignty and territorial integrity. But at the same time, it is also meant to be preemptive as a deterrent against further escalation by the United States and those separation and independence-seeking elements in Taiwan beyond a point of no return. Because if that happens, that will spell real disaster for peace and stability, first and foremost in the Taiwan Strait, but with serious implications for the wider Asia-Pacific region as well. So in a way, what we're doing, I think is the responsible thing to do, just to prevent something worse from happening that will damage the interest of everyone, including countries like New Zealand.
When you say something worse, what is your concern there? What do you mean?
Because, you see, over the years, we have a status, because there has been a lot of talk about the status quo being broken. Indeed, the status quo has been broken, not by China, but by the United States and the Taiwanese authorities. Because this, what is central to the status quo ante would be the recognition that there is only one China and the commitments internationally on the one China principle. But since the Taiwan government came to power, it has been consistently taken steps, but egged on by some forces, including some of those in the United States, to walk back the One China principle, the shared recognition on both sides of the Taiwan Strait. There is only one China, and both sides of the Taiwan Strait belong to that same one China. And on the part of the United States as well, more recently, they've taken steps to upgrade their official interactions with Taiwan. They've even forayed into military exchanges and military cooperation, and they've, contrary to their commitment to face down and eventually face out arms sales to Taiwan, they've faced up those sales to Taiwan, both in terms of quantity and quality. And with this latest visit by Speaker Pelosi, they've upped the ante significantly. And instead of going for a course correction, they have doubled down with a follow-up visit. So we need to take the countermeasures to draw a line in the sand, because if this is allowed to go on, it is going to be a very slippery road
to a military conflict.
Well, certainly.
Is that your concern?
Yeah, certainly. We won't seek any military conflict, because we have always stood for peace and opposed war. But if war or military conflict is imposed upon us, but we have no choice but to respond. But let me make a follow-up point. You may have noticed the most recent white paper we have issued on the question of Taiwan and the unification of the motherland. This is the third white paper we have issued on the question. And in each and every one of them, we have made it clear consistently that what we'll be aiming for would be peaceful reunification of the country. And over the years, we've been making consistent efforts to bring about that result. And at some point, we made some significant progress with the cooperation from the authorities from the other side of the strait. We've established a framework for dialogues to take place, and we've established a framework for economic cooperation across the strait to take place. But since Tsai Ing-wen came to power, that process has gone into reverse. And we have made it very clear that we will still make our best endeavors to aim for peaceful solution, a peaceful reunification of the country. But we won't rule out any options. We want to keep all options on the table, not because we want to seek it, but because we want to keep it as an option, as a deterrent against escalatory moves on the other side. And that would also serve as the best guarantee that there will be a peaceful solution and the country will be reunified peacefully.
The Solomon Islands surprised many in April by signing a security pact with China, and critics warned it could lead to increased militarization in the Pacific. The Solomons deal was a diplomatic flashpoint of sorts.
I think it is a disturbing development. Having said that, we've got to be respectful of the sovereignty of the government of the Solomon Islands. Preaching a lesson from Canberra and Wellington is not going to help.
Great to see you too.
Both New Zealand and Australia were caught off guard. Foreign Minister Nanaia Mahuta called the arrangement unwelcome and unnecessary. But shortly after it was finalised, China approached 10 other Pacific nations and pitched broad cooperation agreements.
So just to be really clear, you think New Zealand needs to consider increasing its military capacity, buying drones and potentially buying anti-ship or anti-aircraft missiles?
Yeah, we're a maritime nation. We've got an enormous maritime space with our EEZ. It's now going to be contested. And all of China's moves in the last 5 years have been taking us in this direction. But now, as I said, you know, time has sped up. We've got to be prepared to defend our interests, and we can't do that with words.
A month after that interview, Defence Minister Pēnei Henare announced a review of New Zealand's defence policy. And the Foreign Affairs Minister told us New Zealand would consider a range of different changes.
But the fact that we are consulting with the Pacific on our defence approach, I think signals that we are willing to hear back from our Pacific partners about what the need is, how we're able to respond, and therefore the consequences of what a response looks like.
So then, I asked Ambassador Wang Xiaolong how New Zealand's response to the Solomons deal affected our relationship with China.
I think when the news broke that a potential security deal, so to speak, between China and Solomon Islands was in the offing, there's a lot of misinformation and thus misunderstanding. Because at the time, there was the talk about the possibility of a military base or even long-term military presence by China in Solomon Islands. That turned out as to be entirely untrue. Because what happened as far as the deal is concerned is that we were responding to a specific request from the Solomon Islands for assistance and support in terms of law enforcement focused security assistance in response to what happened in Honiara, for example, towards the end of last year. Yeah. And as part of the chaos that occurred, the riots that occurred in Honiara, a large part of the city centre was burned down, and it turned out that the local Chinese community bore the brunt of the impact. And even today, as we speak, a lot of them are still left homeless because of what happened there. So I think in the wake of those developments, the Solomon Islands came to us with a specific request for assistance in terms of law enforcement to increase their capacity to maintain law and order and wider social stability. So that's what the deal or the agreement is about, and nothing else and nothing more. But this is taking place at the same time as in the context of the overall relationship we have with the Solomon Islands and with perhaps some of the other the Pacific countries as well. Because as has been pointed out by, for example, Prime Minister Ardern, China has a long-standing relationship with some of these Pacific Island countries. Because remember, we established between China and New Zealand diplomatic relations 50 years ago. And our relations with a lot of these Pacific countries are almost as old as our relationship with New Zealand. So we've been there for a long time. And what we've been doing essentially in the Pacific, because we are fellow developing countries, and within the framework of what we call the South-South Cooperation, the fellow developing countries helping each other, we've been providing development assistance to them, aiming for common development, addressing some of the poverty issues that exist in these countries, but also helping them to increase their capacity to address some of the long-term issues like climate change. So in that sense, I think we, between New Zealand and China, we share a lot of common interests in the South Pacific, because both of us would like to see peace and stability first and foremost in the region. And in that respect, let me say in very clear terms that as far as we are concerned, we're not interested at all in so-called geopolitical or geostrategic competition. We are not doing it here in the South Pacific. We are not doing it anywhere else in the world. What we're trying to do is to help them for common development. And in that respect, because New Zealand has been helping these countries as well over the years, and we appreciate that, because we understand that New Zealand has long-term traditional links and influence in this region. We respect those, and we hope that on that basis we could work with New Zealand to pull our resources together, to join our hands, to help these Pacific Island countries.
Did you have any concerns as to New Zealand's response to the Solomon's deal and to the proposed deals with other Pacific nations?
As I said, there was some misunderstanding in the initial stage, but I think those misunderstandings have been clarified largely. So I think we have a better understanding of where we come from, each of us, on this, as far as this region is concerned. And I think we appreciate the observation made by Prime Minister Ardern again at the China Business Summit, that New Zealand is willing to explore opportunities to work together with China. We are willing to do that as well.
Well, it's really interesting you raise that, because I interviewed New Zealand's Foreign Minister Nanaia Mahuta a few weeks ago. And I asked her at the time if Pacific nations were too indebted to China. And she said this, quote, "I'd say there's a level of indebtedness that sits across the whole of the Pacific to financial institutions, including the way in which China has funded certain countries, and it's a key area of vulnerability." So I wondered, in your development assistance goals, what responsibility does China bear in ensuring Pacific nations don't end up in a situation like Sri Lanka in economic and political turmoil?
I'm glad you mentioned Sri Lanka, but let me come to this. What we've been trying to do in the South Pacific and in other parts of the world, be it in Latin America, Africa, or closer to home, Asia, with developing countries, is to trying to increase their capacity for indigenous development through development of infrastructure, building up some of the key industries, and helping the development of the local capacity as well, through training, education. So the South Pacific is no exception. And we are doing this largely through donations. But of course, we provide some of the loans as well. But most of them are on comparable terms, or very concessional and comparable terms as compared to some of the other donors like New Zealand and some of the multilateral financial institutions like the World Bank, like the Asia Development Bank. And if you look at Sri Lanka, the loans provided by China accounts for only about 10% of their overall external indebtedness. So most of that is owed to the other Western countries and the multilateral financial institutions. So even the Sri Lankans themselves would tell you that what has occurred, the difficulties they're in at this moment, has very little to do with their cooperative relationship with China. But as a matter of fact, both in Sri Lanka and in some of the South Pacific countries, again, what we're trying to do is to help them to develop their capability for long-term sustainable development. And none of these countries has fallen into debt distress because of their relationship with China. And actually, what have been helping them is to make development in these countries more sustainable over the long run, so that instead of falling into traps of indebtedness, they could lift themselves out of the trap of underdevelopment.
While life in some countries continues as if there is no pandemic, China is still pursuing what it calls dynamic zero COVID. The country has refused to use foreign-made mRNA vaccines, and compared to before the pandemic, access to China is significantly restricted. Travellers face quarantine, and critics say the approach is stunting the global economic recovery. I wondered, what have you learned about the pandemic as New Zealand transitioned from COVID elimination, as we called it, to living with the virus?
Well, I'm here as an observer because I have my opinions on what is going on, but I'd rather keep my counsel, because who am I to tell you what is right or what is wrong or what to do or what not to do? But I think New Zealand has been generally recognized internationally as one of the best success stories in terms of your preparedness and response to COVID. And I congratulate New Zealand for that. And we have our own way of dealing with it, but we share some similarities, at least in the initial stage, in our approach in terms of elimination. But I think the policies in both countries have evolved since then.
Why is China still pursuing a zero COVID policy?
We characterize it as dynamic zero COVID policy. So if you look at the details, our measures have been evolving over time. For example, in terms of, we don't have massive lockdowns these days. We are targeting some of the restrictive measures better, focusing on smaller areas where we have these surges in caseloads. And we have also reduced the number of, we still have MIQ in place in China for travelers going back, going into China.
10 days, right?
No, it's come down to 7 days now.
7 days plus three at home.
Three at home. But as compared to what it used to be, at the beginning it was 21 days. And at some point it came down to 14 days, and now it's 7. But I'm confident that with the virus being brought under further control, I think with supporters, with the data and the best available science, we'll further adapt our COVID measures.
Tell me a bit more about that, because right at the start of this interview, you told me about the importance that China places on person-to-person relationships. Mm. I noted that at the China Business Summit you said, quote, China's door of opening up will never close, it will only open wider.
Yes.
But at the moment it is extremely difficult for people to visit China. Mm-hmm. Chinese citizens who leave China know they face that quarantine period. If they can make it home. Even your staff here in Wellington are still pursuing a version of zero COVID in New Zealand. So how does China expect the world to maintain face-to-face relationships if it's shut off to the world?
I think the face-to-face relationships, including the travels across borders, have resumed, and I think it is increasing in a sharply rising trajectory. I'm confident that as things move, the border control measures will further ease. But there's a trade-off, to be honest. There's a trade-off here. What happens in the short term, the price we have to pay, but with what happens in the long term. Because as we see it, given the circumstances of China, because if you think that doing it in a country like New Zealand, a country of 5 million, is difficult enough, try to multiply the magnitude of difficulty about 300 times when it comes to China.
Which begs the question why, I suppose.
Yes, right, because the population is simply so large. Even when the rate of infection is relatively low, with the control measures, with the vaccination campaign, but still, because the base is so huge, even if a small number of people, small proportion of people get infected, that could be still quite significant by any standard. And those would exert enormous pressure on the public health system. And all along, I think this is what we share between New Zealand and China. We put people first. We put people at the center of everything we do, including the control and response to the pandemic. Our first priority consistently has been protecting people's lives. So on that basis, we integrate the needs for wider economic and social development. And as things evolve, I think we'll be in a better position. And we're already taking measures to support the economy. We're already taking measures to restart the cross-border travels. And people are coming back to China, and at the same time, people are beginning to come back to New Zealand as well, particularly the students from China.
For several years on our program, we've followed the plight of Maulan Nur Muhammad, who is the brother of a Uyghur New Zealander who is imprisoned in Xinjiang. His family here say they've received intimidating phone calls from the Chinese embassy and that they've been banned from contacting their family in Xinjiang. In what ways can you protect the rights of Uyghur New Zealanders to contact their family in Xinjiang province?
Let me tell you in very clear and unmistakable terms, none of those things that has been claimed has actually happened, because none of my staff has made any calls to any one of these people about anything. Yeah. But if there is a request for help, if we are approached, we'll deal with that in accordance with the necessary procedures. And providing help, consular help and support for our citizens here in New Zealand is an important part of our responsibility. But let me come to a wider point on the human rights situation in Xinjiang. Because we don't have much time, but suffice to say that most recently we have a delegation of about 30 ambassadors from the Muslim or Islamic countries visiting Xinjiang. They had some in-depth exchanges with the people where people there, including the Uyghur people, or what we call the Uyghur ethnic people. The conclusion arrived at by these Muslim country ambassadors after their field visit is that we have really protected our minority people well, including their religious rights. I don't know whether you are aware of, for example, in Xinjiang, the Uyghur population has tripled in its size as compared to 30 years ago. And the number of mosques in Xinjiang, you can guess where it stands. It's 24,000 mosques.
I suppose the question is
that's the biggest intensity or the biggest concentration of mosques anywhere in this world, including a lot of the Muslim or Islamic countries. So that is a small window showcasing the way the religious rights of people are upheld and respected in Xinjiang by the Chinese government.
Overnight, I note the UN Special Rapporteur for Modern Slavery has released a report which says China's treatment of the Uyghurs could amount to slavery as a crime against humanity. Do you personally feel any sense of shame as to the way that China has treated that Uyghur minority?
Well, let me start by saying that you may have noticed as well that the spokesperson of our foreign ministry has rejected that report as completely baseless. You're right. It's a UN rapporteur's report. It's not a UN report because UN is essentially the membership. It's not even a report by the Secretariat of the United Nations. And the rapporteur is an individual entrusted with a special responsibility. But apparently that particular person is not living up to his responsibility. Because
it's one of many reports though, isn't
right,
it?
Right, but if you look at the details, there's only one paragraph making some generic accusations without any evidence to back it up. And if you look at the details, the notes, that's the interesting part. Because it's this usual suspects is the one or two so-called scholars or institutions, the references to those reports as backstop for the so-called conclusion drawn by this particular UN rapporteur. But actually, I think this is a classical case of the what they call the wrap-up smear tactics. Because you make an accusation, that's not from me, that's from Speaker Pelosi, yeah, about what happens in the United States politics. You make an accusation, you find a couple of people to do a write-up, and you get it published somewhere, and you point to that as validation. That's exactly what has happened as far as this particular report is concerned. But that's essentially a dog chasing its own tail, going around in circles. But that's totally, totally baseless. And you may also be aware that most recently we have notified the United Nations about our ratification of the two, what they call the core conventions on forced labor under the auspices of the International Labor Organization, the labor window for the United Nations family. So that is, that again shows our firm commitment to stamp out completely forced labor in China. That is what we've been doing consistently through our domestic policies, and this latest ratification of these two conventions is another indication of our strong commitment to that cause.
Finally then, when will Jacinda Ardern be invited to Beijing, and what else can New Zealand and China do to improve our relation at a time of global instability?
Well, we've been looking forward to another visit by the Prime Minister for some time now. But because of COVID, again, this hasn't taken place. But hopefully, as the border controls ease further in both countries, we could have her in China as soon as possible, hopefully within the course of this year. Because this year is very special for us, for our relationship. We'll be marking the 50th anniversary. It's time to celebrate, of course, because we've made tremendous progress together over the years. If you compare that to what the relationship used to be about 50 years ago, we've come really a long way. But at the same time, as I pointed out in my presentation at the China Business Summit, there's no room for complacency, because as compared to the demand from both sides, as compared to the aspirations from both peoples, and as compared to the potential that exists, there's still a long way to go. For example, in terms of trade, which already has become arguably the strongest pillar of our relationship, we still have huge room for further growth. And apart from the traditional products, we could also diversify into some new areas, which could help to stimulate the further growth of trade both ways between our two countries. We could go into agribusiness, we could go into bioproducts. These are some of the strengths of New Zealand, and we could build on, and from which we could benefit as far as China is concerned. I was yesterday attending a ceremony celebrating 30 years of a sister city between Palmerston North and Guiyang in China. I think that's a very good showcase of what has happened and how the relationship has benefited both sides. Because apart from the trade and everything, New Zealand export going into China, but at the same time, the cooperation we have conducted in cattle farming and in kiwi fruit farming have helped to grow the relevant industries in China. So this is another example of how both sides could benefit for such a relationship. But of course, again, the relationship between us is much broader than trade as such. It's way beyond the transactional. We have other areas as well. For example, the very strong, deep people-to-people links between our two countries. That's what I've found out since my arrival as ambassador this time around. The community here, the Chinese community here, is one of the biggest. It's about a quarter of a million people here. So they're contributing enormously to the relationship and to the local development. And also at the international level, both of us support peace and development in the world, and both of us would want to see peace and stability in the Asia-Pacific region, and both of us will want to support international cooperation to address some of the common challenges like climate change, like the ongoing COVID pandemic. And actually, we have started working together bilaterally, but more importantly, at a regional level and even globally. And these, I think, are areas we share enormous common interests. And these are areas, I think, with great potential for future growth in terms of the relationship. So, as ambassador, I'm excited. I've come in at this opportune and important juncture in our relationship, and I'm ready to work with our friends in New Zealand to take the relationship to the next level, to give increasing substance to the comprehensive strategic partnership we have established between us.